So as the next speaker, I would like to introduce Mr. Keith Springer from Tasmania Parks and Wildlife.
Good to have the home council. Thank you, and also thanks to my fellow presenters for some really interesting presentations this morning. It's been really informative. This session I'm going to look at primarily the impacts of introduced alien species and opportunities to redress some of those at a relatively local level. So the site that we're talking about is Macquarie Island, which is a World Heritage listed sub-Antarctic island. Location wise, a long way away from anywhere really. It's 1500 kilometres from Hobart, and apart from some other small sub-Antarctic islands, the nearest land mass is the South Island of New Zealand. The island is just under 13,000 hectares in area. It's long and thin because it's the exposed crest of an oceanic ridge, which extends all the way from the South Island of New Zealand to Antarctica. So about 33 kilometres long and 3-4 kilometres wide. So I won't dwell on the natural beauty of the island so much as looking at some of the invasive species that have inhabited the island and the impacts that they've caused. So, and again, I won't dwell on these two, but weka was a rail that was introduced from New Zealand for food, and that was eradicated by 1988. Cats have been present on the island for around about 200 years, nearly 200 years before they were eradicated early in the 2000s. So their primary impact was on burrowing seabird predation. However, after those two species were eradicated, we were left with three species on the island: European rabbits, ship rats, Rattus rattus, and house mice. And the impacts of these were largely visible in terms of rabbits, because you could see the devastation that rabbits caused by removal of vegetation. However, the impacts of rodents are less visible because they are impacting invertebrates, which are fairly cryptic, and also eating the eggs and chicks of burrowing seabirds. So instead of seeing large flocks of seabirds, you're not seeing large flocks of seabirds, primarily as a result of predation by rats. So what do some of these impacts look like, particularly from rabbits? So this is an indication of reasonably healthy tussock vegetation community at a viewing platform which was visited by tourists. And by 2000, and this is after some rabbit control for about 20 years using the myxoma virus, within about a few years it turned into a veritable wasteland really, so very heavily impacted. This is a close-up of a tussock plant that grow up to about waist high on a big pedestal, and the rabbits would get into the crown of that and just keep eating from the middle. And then as they worked their way out, they would eventually kill the whole plant. So we had large areas that looked like this. And so the island became, which used to be known as the green sponge, because it's so wet and it was green, is now looking more like the brown sponge, because it was still wet but no longer green. This is an area very close to the station maintained by the Australian Antarctic Division, and again heavily impacted by rabbits, which had removed all of the vegetation from around that site. This photo I took in 2006, and we'll come back to that image a little bit later. Very briefly, the concept of removing vertebrate pests from islands is not particularly new or rare. There are over 1,000 islands worldwide where this sort of activity has been undertaken, or this sort of management work has been undertaken. And certainly around Mexico has been very prominent in this field, particularly with removal of cats. New Zealand has probably pioneered the field and has done a large number of islands around the coast of New Zealand, but also the area around the UK and even Europe is starting to a little bit, and up into America as well. When we started looking at how would we go about this exercise, we looked at similar operations worldwide. worldwide to where the same species had been targeted, and we wanted to see what the largest area was to get a sense of the challenge in front of us. So the largest area where mice have been eradicated was around about 700 hectares, and for rabbits it was the French island of St. Paul in the Indian Ocean, not much bigger, about 750 hectares. Ship rats, an island in the western Australia, have been cleared of ship rats at about 1,000 hectares. And so the challenge in sense of scale for us is the quarry. So it was even from that, you can get a sense of how ambitious and challenging it was. But to give us some encouragement, the New Zealand subantarctic island of Campbell Island had been cleared of Norway rats. And so we were able to adapt a lot of the methodology that they use for that operation and use that to base the quarry work on. We had about a 3-year planning period, and in that planning period we had a lot of regulatory work to do. We had over 30 separate approvals and permits that were required before we could undertake the work. We had quite a lot of staff to recruit over the period of the project. We ended up with 60 individuals working on it in one form or another. There was a lot of strategy that went into this, because it was pretty rare to do a multi-species eradication project. And so each individual species has to be understood and the interrelationships between those species and the natural environment understood before we could be confident that we had a good chance of success in this sort of work. We needed to engage with stakeholders and keep communities informed to ensure that we had widespread support for this sort of work. Because of the remoteness of the island, logistics played a huge part, and we needed large ships and lots of helicopters and large amounts of fuel and bait and that sort of thing. So it was a significant amount of planning time went into the logistics of it. Several contracts for all of those sort of aspects that I've just mentioned. And we relied heavily on the use of dogs as detection tools for finding surviving rabbits after a baiting period, and those dogs took a long time to train because we needed to ensure that they would not harm non-target species. So a lot of the time taken to train dogs to go into a non-target version. And finally, we had a network of peer people around the world who contributed a lot to reviewing our strategy and planning to ensure that they thought we were on the right track and had no anything. So I'll just talk briefly about how we went about it. Effectively, we use an aerial baiting program, spreading an anticoagulant bait from helicopters across the island. The use of GPS technology is critical in this, because using GPS we can set flight lines at an exact distance apart, and the helicopter's task is to fly those lines, spreading bait from a bucket slung underneath, and we can then ensure that the whole island is covered accurately and that every single target animal has an opportunity to find and eat a bait. We expected that the bait drop would eradicate the mice and the rats based on prior experience elsewhere, but that same experience had told us that while we were getting nearly all the rabbits, we should expect a few survivors. And because of that, we then had a fairly extensive hunting program planned for after the bait drop. And we used the Khaleesi virus initially before the aerial baiting took place as a strategy to try and reduce non-target mortality where scavenging seabirds could be eating poisoned rabbits. This is basically just what the island looked like in terms of a helicopter airdrop point of view. So each colour is a day's baiting group. So we started at one end of the island, we started at the south, and then we just maintained a rolling front and spread bait northwards as we went. For the hunting phase, we planned on 5 years. We ended up being able to finish it in just over 3, so it was quite a significant cost saving as a result of that. We had teams of about 12 hunters, and we had 12 dogs involved in the project as well. We had expected, from our initial calculations, we'd expected that even with a 1% survival of rabbits, that would still be over a couple of hundred rabbits. But in the event, once we started, we found just 12, which was a pretty phenomenal outcome in terms of the effectiveness of the bait and the Khaleesi virus that we used prior. So a lot of people and a lot of dogs chasing very small number of rabbits, but of course when you're gone as eradication, any one of those rabbits, or regularly any two, can mean that you fail and you're back to square one before very long. We also took a team down to monitor for rodent presence to try and give us the confidence that we had indeed eradicated rodents, because as you can imagine on an island that big and that rugged, it's very difficult to be sure that you've in fact successfully removed every one. But after a year of searching with three dogs and two people, we basically didn't find any.
Just a little bit about that. So each
team that went down was deployed for a year. They effectively were able to search the island twice, and they all carried GPSs so that we could log their search patterns. And when you combine all those search patterns, it just looks like a big blue island that you can't really distinguish the individual tracks. But that all that blue mass represents 92,000 kilometres of people walking the island searching for any sign of a rabbit or a rodent. And in terms of the main goal of this, of course, is not just to kill rabbits and rodents. The goal is to try and restore Macquarie Island to a more natural ecosystem. So that's what it's all about. And very quickly after this project, and the baiting only finished in 2011, and the hunting finished earlier this year. But even by 2012, we were seeing quite significant recovery of a number of aspects. This may not look very remarkable, this mass of cobwebs over here, but it was quite remarkable to anybody who visited Macquarie, because nobody had ever seen cobwebs in the grass, things like that, because spiders tended to be eaten by mice. So it was only when mice were removed that we suddenly started seeing this sort of response in the vegetation. It was quite eye-opening, because while we expected recovery of invertebrates, I don't think anybody had stopped to actually think what that might look like. We just thought, oh, you would be more bugs, but it wasn't until quite a graphic representation like this that we realised that that had a physical dimension to the recovery as well. Burrowing sea birds are breeding more successfully now that there's no rats eating their eggs or eating their chicks, and we found that species that were lost from the main island but still existed on offshore rock stacks are now coming back in quite good numbers and breeding on the main island. So while it's early days, the momentum of that recovery should gain pace in the years to come. And in terms of vegetation, this sequence of photos is of an explosion block that was built in 2006 to try and quantify the rate at which vegetation would grow if no rabbits were eating it. So even in 1 year, by 2007, the grass was, the tussock was ankle high. By 2008, it was starting to come up to the top of the fence, and this is only 2 years without being grazed, so the recovery was quite dramatic. And then by 2013, 2 years after nearly all rabbits were removed by baiting, you couldn't really see the explosion block because all the tusk around it had grown up to a similar level. And that slide that I showed you earlier on, taken in 2005, sorry, earlier this year, I retook the same photo, and quite a graphic demonstration of how quickly this ecosystem can recover once those invasive species are removed. Just to finish off, a couple of things which I think contributed significantly to the success of the project, and one which I think Virginia referred to was the sporadic nature of funding and how much that can influence the outcome of the project. And I think for Macquarie, one of the key success factors was the fact that we had funding committed by the Australian and Tasmanian governments right from the outset. They committed to an 8-year project and funding it right the way through. So that enabled us to progress with a lot of contractual arrangements and certainty about planning, knowing that we had the funding locked in and we didn't have to rely on annual competitive funding bids, which could have caused the loss of all that we've gained so far. But things like the planning phase were incredibly important, and I think once we got down to the island, the value of all that planning work was quite apparent, because we had everything we needed, which is just as well because we couldn't go back to get anything if we'd forgotten it. So that thoroughness of planning certainly stood us in good stead. And as you can imagine, with an 80-year project with a lot of logistics requirements, we had our share of challenges and obstacles, and we had to find ways of resolving all those before we could make sure that the project was on track and eventually succeed. And particularly this one here, which I think is going to be familiar to most of you who work in the protected area field. If you don't have the dedicated staff who don't treat it as a 9-to-5 job, but believe in what they're doing and believe that they can make a real difference and achieve some really ambitious goals, you are likely to succeed. So the dedication of our staff that we had, particularly in the harsh weather conditions on the Murray, was a real testament to the success of the project. And being such a wide ranging project, we had significant input from particularly the Australian Antarctic Division and a lot of other people in Parks and Wildlife as well. Thank you very much.